a story was published via via Motherboard on Vice, and the title is the following. It says Spotify CEO defends keeping transphobic Joe Rogan on podcast online. Multiple sources inside Spotify describe an all-hands meeting in which Spotify CEO Daniel Ek discussed the company's handling of the controversial podcast, which is funny because this comes off the back of Daniel, the same dude, Ek, having to come out and essentially defend the position of Spotify in terms of how they split and, you know, how they split their revenue with artists, and the fact that he was basically saying that he basically accused artists of being lazy, or a segment of the artists that complain for not putting out a lot of music, for not adjusting to the times, and, you know, catering to the platform. A lot of debate around it, right, was kind of brewing, and, you know, that got under people's bonnet, you know, and, you know, it is what it is. But this debate was more interesting because you could have seen this coming a mile off, right, considering that you know, Spotify is a Scandinavian based company, or was founded by a guy from Scandinavia, considering their politics, considering the politics of most startups. It did seem quite interesting that they'd go after Joe Rogan, right? They'd kind of want him to boost their podcasting platform, to kind of bring them into a new dawn, to make, you know, acquire some more users. It was an interesting approach because you would have known that one way or the other, just even through Joe Rogan's guest or just through some of the things he says himself, there was definitely going to be an issue. There was definitely going to be a butting of ideologies. There's definitely going to be a butting of worldviews that you just can't kind of get around. There's no changing the minds of the people who think Joe Rogan's a transphobe, and there's no changing the mind of someone like a Joe Rogan to take people seriously who dye their hair pink and complain about the pronouns people refer to them as, right? It's just not going to happen, right? They ideologically come from two different places. They're always going to butt heads. And it's interesting as opposition to being a CEO, because these are decisions that definitely define your company for the long run. And sometimes you have to upset your own team in order to kind of get to the next stage you're getting to. It's kind of one of those unfortunate positions that most CEOs come into, right? You read most accounts, you read most stories. Everyone kind of has this moment as a CEO, as a leader of a big company, where they make a decision that isn't very popular with their own employees, but allows them to, you know, grow into a new sector, evolve into a new market, completely change their approach, whatever it may be, dominate as a sector. There is this inflection point, this sort of like fork of the road that you need to decide to go along, and unfortunately it's going to upset some of the employees that were fundamental to you actually building your company and getting to a place that you are now at the moment. And Joe Rogan's one of them, and they've paid him so much money, if you believe the figures, 100 million up front, with, you know, more at the back end if he hits certain milestones, which he's obviously going to do. And they've invested heavily in this idea that if they license this guy's podcast on their platform, it's going to attract the eyes, it's going to make them a serious player in the game, blah 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 blah. There's obviously some potential for them to do some other stuff with Joe in the future if things get, you know, if they develop into more of a tech company. You could see this growing and growing and growing. So it's interesting to see what the approach will be from Daniel Ek. How does he maneuver around this, because this is a very, very pivotal moment for Spotify and how they go forward. Let's continue with the article. Said Spotify in all hands company meeting on Wednesday, Spotify's CEO Daniel Ek defended keeping transphobic content from hugely popular podcaster Joe Rogan on the audio platform. Some staff inside the company feel alienated by Spotify's hosting of a certain Joe Rogan Experience episodes, according to copies of some of the questions presented to the meeting obtained by Motherboard. The new signals how Spotify, as it moves into the podcasting space beyond music, is facing content moderation decisions more commonly associated with social platforms like Facebook and Twitter, which is so difficult to judge. You know, you start moving the goalpost, you start banning people, you then are held to a certain standard, other things change. It's just not an enviable position to be in whatsoever. Spotify has already removed Jerry episodes from right-wing figures, including Alex Jones and Gavin McGinnis. Now, that's the more interesting part of it, right? And this maybe confirms what a lot of people have speculate online, because when Joe Rogan made the switch to Spotify, a lot of episodes supposedly went missing during the port over, which a lot of people didn't agree with, didn't really believe, right? If you've ever kind of had to import your RSS feed onto another platform or to get it submitted, you'll know that things take a while to kind of, populate on the new feed or on a new platform, but they do populate in chronological order for the most part. And give it a day or two and your most of your library, even if you've got 1,000 plus episodes, will appear in its entirety on that platform. The fact that the ones that are missing were from the more controversial characters, with the exception of a few, with one or two here and there, goes to show that for sure Spotify came in editorially, content wise, and decided to remove some of the episodes. Owen Benjamin's, Alex Jones, Gavin McGuinness, Amani Apollos, because they essentially have banned them for their platform anyway, so it makes complete sense. But I didn't Oh, that I didn't like, but I find it interesting that Joe Rogan, number one, didn't address it, which is odd considering he's, he rallies against identity politics, he rallies against gender issues, he rallies against censorship. It's one of his kind of main tropes that he kind of goes back to again and again. He's always kind of ranting about censorship, right? He essentially had Twitter on with Tim Pool and one of their lawyers basically talking about censorship, right? And dead naming and banning people on the platform. And they went through a complete whole back and forth. That was one of his main go-tos. So for him not to address it at all is concerning. The fact that he kind of leaked the news to Alex Jones that, oh, we were porting the shows over and we're actually going to have a Joe Rogan best of hits and leave it on the YouTube was bullshit. We all knew that was crap, right? We all knew he was lying, which is not, it's not a bad thing, I guess. If you're getting paid $100 million, right, for your podcast by Spotify, and the other 100 million is dependent on you hitting some milestones and also being agreeable and also maybe, allowing some maneuver in terms of what is allowed on the content, then it is what it is. It's not selling out. I think he's been in the game long enough for that. But it would have been good to approach it in some way, shape, or form and tell the audience. But again, maybe it feels like he doesn't owe anybody an explanation. But this is definitely proof or evidence of some kind of evidence towards that points more in the direction of Spotify deciding to remove the episodes as opposed to Joe Rogan saying, hey, I'm going to put them on YouTube instead. I don't think that was a fact. So it continues. It says in the case of Joe Rogan, a total of 10 meetings have been held with various groups and individuals to hear the respective concerns, X said. According to free sources, and some of them want Rogan removed because of what he said in the past. Oh, look, I even put a snitch hotline there in the middle. He says three sources provided Motherboard with some of the questions submitted to the town hall meeting. Motherboard granted them anonymity as they weren't authorized to speak of the press about internal Spotify issues. So two of those questions submitted in the Q&A section of the meeting highlight some of the Spotify's employees' concerns about Joe Rogan's content. And again, just imagine the amount of money that's online. The amount of money that's on the line, not only just what they paid him, but potential earnings, the legality of it. Like, this is a decision they cannot take lightly. I'm sure they cannot take this lightly. But again, most likely they're not. They're gonna have to side with Joe Rogan if they want to really take things to the next level. Because the moment they back under the pressure of their own staff members because of this ideological issue, it's probably gonna be mark the end of Spotify. For sure, for you can probably put a bet on that one. So here's the quote. It says, one of the submitted question was, many LGBTQA plus ally and Spotifyers feel unwelcome and alienated because of leadership response to JRE conversations. What is your message to these employees? Jesus, this is a hot one. Another one said, why has Spotify chosen to ignore Spectrum ERG's guidance about the transphobic content in JRE's catalogue, referring to the group of Spotify workers who focus on related issues? At the meeting, Eck also told employees not to leak to the media, noting, if we can't be open and confidential debates, we will have to move these discussions to closed doors, which is a very sneaky way to approach this, right? He must have known signing Joe Rogan was going to be an issue with his staff members, who are probably liberal, left-leaning people. He must know it's going to be an issue. There must have been conversations prior to this. So to suddenly now gag your employees from talking about this publicly in any way, shape, or form, again, maybe not, with their name attached to it, but in any sort of anonymous sources, really anonymous fashion, sorry, is really fucked up. I think so. I think they're within their rights to voice their concerns about it. Of course, if it comes to a point where they identify the leaks and you get fired, you can't then complain. It is what it is. They set the rules. But if they're willing to kind of come out with, you know, without putting their name to it, but, you know, at least accurately represent their side of the argument, it's fine. But again, I think this is where you get paid. This is where you actually earn your coin as a CEO. What do you do in this position? If that was me and I decided to go with Joe Rogan and use that to kind of push my new service into a new dawn, then of course I stick with the guy because I've invested $100 million into him, right? I have no other option. And I have to, but you have to be in a position where you can, of course, listen to the concerns of your employees, acknowledge their voice, but then also be very clear in that you are the leader, you are the person that's ultimately hired to make these tough decisions, right? You're not there to lead some of the some of the all hands on a Friday, right? You're there to basically guide, oversee, and make some of the tough calls that are essentially going to ensure that Spotify stays around for the next 5 to 10 years, because there's no guarantee of that either, right? TikTok comes around and decides to start a streaming service, right? There's no telling how quickly that could grow and become the dominant leader. So you can't take a position for granted. You have to kind of always be on the offensive. And this is one of the offensive moves they decided to do. They decided to kind of, you know, cut the nose to spite their face and hire somebody like Joe Rogan, even though he's maybe, he maybe goes against some of their staff's outlooks and perspective on life, but it is what it is. So it continues. It says, other concerns, specifically over a recent episode, X said, and Joe Rogan and the episode in question have been reviewed extensively. The fact that we aren't changing our position doesn't mean we aren't listening, which I like. It just means that we have a different judgment call. And I think the actual video in question was this one, where the one of the reasons why some of Joe Rogan's own gets backlash is, I guess, Caitlyn Jenner decided to voice her concerns about Joe Rogan on TMZ, which definitely put some added pressure on him. And it's funny because he's been going at the Kardashians and the Jenners for years, right? He's got them joke on his special. He said some very spicy things about Caitlyn Jenner. He obviously isn't a fan of Caitlyn in this incarnation at all. He was obviously a big fan of Bruce, that he says quite often, right? That we lost an Olympic athlete or something along those lines. He said some really, really questionable things. So it only was a matter of time before it kind of, you know, the straw finally broke the camel's back. And this is Caitlyn Jenner's response to Joe Rogan's constant jibes at her and his family, at her and her family. Sorry.
Continues. Rogan, this is not the first time he said things like this. He's a homophobic, transphobic ass. And he calls my family, especially the girls, crazy bitches. And he does this all the time.
Part of me thinks a lot of it has to do with the fact that Joe Rogan, he sees a lot of himself in that family. He knows he could have easily been Caitlyn Jenner in this situation. The way he kind of frames it is that, oh, because Caitlyn Jenner, as Bruce back then, was surrounded by so many crazy females that it was only a matter of time before that crazy somehow infected his brain and then decided that he wanted to transition, right? That's kind of his way of thinking of the joke through. So maybe Joe Rogan, oddly enough, sees himself in Caitlyn Jenner and that family and says, bloody hell, I could have gone down this route too. And, you know, hurt people, that sort of good stuff. And maybe that constant ragging on them is about that, or just the fact that they're just a bit of a freak show of a family, right? In the nicest way possible. They just are, right? They've essentially built an entire career and empire off of exploiting their inner family dynamics for the world to see. They've made themselves gazillionaires, right? In the process too, they've redefined what fame is, right? They've essentially, they might have been the reason why people don't actually recognize talent anymore that much, right? Remember back in the day when you actually have an actual talent to be famous or be well known. Now you're just well known for just being well known. The term public figure comes to mind, right? What does that even mean? So maybe that's the reason why, but I'm actually quite happy to see Caitlyn finally respond and say something, because some of the jabs that she's been getting on Joe Rogan has been consistent. So I don't think Joe can be mad at Caitlyn kind of ragging on him now.
Let's get real here. My daughters have obviously done extremely well. They're more famous. They have more money than he
famous,
has.
Famous, I'm not too sure about that. Money,
they have just about everything more than he has, okay? He's gotten his fame by putting other people down and
not true,
making jokes about it. My family has done it through hard work. I mean,
hard work, really.
My girls have worked their tail off. They've been smart business women. They are intelligent. They're extraordinarily hardworking. And that's how they've made their businesses and their fame. They didn't do it by making jokes about other people and putting them down.
I think if they could tell jokes, they probably would, but you know.
He says maybe because I was around all these crazy bitches that I, you know, transitioned. It's not even close. I mean, I've been gender dysphoric my entire life. I just tried it to, once I got to the point in life where I could, my kids were raised and they're all doing well and this and that, maybe I could live the remainder of my life authentically. And it has been the most wonderful experience I ever had. I wake up in the morning every day and I'm so happy because I can just be myself all day.
Would you go on his podcast and what would you say to him about telling those kinds of jokes?
Being gender dysphoric, transitioning, all of that is not a joke. It's very serious stuff. You're concerning family.
I had the dancing around the question. It's interesting, right? Would you go on, like, imagine after everything this guy said about your family, about you personally, about the car accident, about your transition, questioning your motives, calling you a bad person, a horrible role model, all these really, really bad things. They ask you point blank about whether you go on the show and Caitlin starts rambling for 20 seconds plus and Indian says, hey, yeah, I probably would go on the show. It's like, you know, isn't that basic? Isn't that a real, isn't that like a representative of just how weird of a family they are, right? After all has been said, you definitely still will go to show. Why? Because it's exposure, because it's a platform, because it allows you to amplify your voice in some extent. It's just, again, I am very curious to see how this plays out, but let me just, I think, end the last bit of the actual article here. I'm interested to see how this plays out with Spotify. I really am. What will they do? Will they buck under the pressure, or will they stick with their cash cow or their whale that they've sort of secured? And again, this also has some impact with the Joe Budden podcast, right? Don't think a lot of the reason why probably Joe Budden didn't get the money that he wanted or the equity or the splits that he wanted, basically, you know, because they spunked most of their cash on Joe. So for them to maybe renege on the deal, to step away from it due to his controversial statements, it's going to be interesting to see how this plays out. So it says, in a specific episode of Joe Rogan Experience, Eck was referring to from July in which Rogan interviewed Abigail Schreier, author of the book Irreversible Damage, a Transgender Craze Seducing Our Daughters. According to one of the sources, from the opening moments of that podcast, Schreier associates transgender youth with those with autism. Schreier and Rogan spent parts of the episode explaining that young people are beginning to be pressured to transition by YouTube and other media. Again, to be fair to Rogan, if you watch the podcast, you know this is one of his staple topics, right? Social justice warriors, hunting, MMA, you know, wanking and himself silly about stand-up comedy, ragging on people who don't make furniture and quit their jobs. Like, he's got this, some staples that he kind of goes through, and this is just one of them. But it's funny that this is so on point in terms of a takedown, right? Even the title of her book is flipping wild, and even just the quote that they pulled out from it. And again, pulling out quotes from a podcast is always a bit disingenuous, right? It takes away from some of the, you know, context of the conversation. But, you know, hey, what can you do? Quote continues here. It says, you realize that people are not looking at this objectively. Rogan said in the podcast, it said, there are activists and they have this agenda, and this agenda is very ideologically driven, that anybody who even thinks that they might be trans should be trans and are trans, and the more trans people are better. Again, what are they going to do, Spotify? In the book, Schreier invalidates the lived experience of trans people by comparing transitioning to adolescent phenomena like eating disorders, self-harm, or occult, according to Men's Health. She also described wanting to transition as a contagion with the potential to affect other children, an entirely scientifically baseless idea, Men's Health noted. Of course, you're going to get your kind of other statements from Men's Health in it, but yeah, that's a wild, again, taking stuff out of context from a podcast is just, it's always going to make you look bad. Ekaterina said that Spotify, we strongly are committed to the LGBTQ plus community and diversity in all its forms. Spotify spokesman told Motherboard, all the employees are respected and we believe that everybody has a right to be heard. We have a number of forums for open and transparent discussion and we encourage rigorous debate on topics across the company. All the content on Spotify is subject to our long-standing content guidelines. Our diverse team of experts reviewed the content in question and then determined that it did not meet the criteria to be removed from our platform. Which again is interesting, isn't it? Like, how far do you go with this sort of stuff? Do you have to remove certain artists' songs? Can you have stuff from like Popcorn and Vybz Kartel on there? Like, well, how far do you take this? Like, of course the drill stuff's a good example, right? They did take down some videos from YouTube, but this is a very sketchy platform to kind of be on, right? Or stage in your business, like when you're trying, when you're basically the judge and jury as to who has a career, especially if you become the monopoly and you have an unfair advantage on the market, right? Imagine if Spotify ends up being, you know, the biggest digital streaming platform in the world. And as an artist, you have to be on there in order to make it, but then you can't make it on there because you have some spicy content. Your music is, the lyrics of your music are maybe not deemed acceptable for that platform. Because again, for ideological purposes, not objectively, just from ideological point of view, that's a very, very slippery slope to get on. So again, what do you do if you're the CEO of Spotify? Do you side with your employees who have got a new position in the first place, right? I'm sure there's some, you know, OG employees there from when they were working out of a bloody co-working space somewhere in the middle of nowhere town. You're suddenly where you want to be now. You've hanged in there. You've secured one of the biggest podcasters in there. You've got a great team. And your team now are complaining that this recent hire, this recent employee, this recent attachment to your company is causing them pain and strife. What do you side with that recent add to your company who is also bringing you in loads of money, right? Because again, they paid him 100 mil, but don't think, you know, he's not generating a lot of cash for this company too. It's a very interesting place to be in. At the same time of writing, Shreya episodes on Spotify, the company has made content moderation decisions to not port several older episodes on the platform. Exactly. However, episodes 9/11 and 9 and 12/55, both of which feature Alex Jones, are not hosted on Spotify, which is again an indication that it was Spotify made a decision editorially and not Joe. I know that story he sold to Alex Jones was a lie. In 2018, Spotify removed Alex Jones' own podcast from the platform for hate content. Spotify is also not hosting episodes in which Rogan interviewed far-right personalities Gavin McGinnis and Chuck Johnson. The Spotify catalogue does include episodes featuring Stefan Molyneux, who Southern Poverty Law Center amplifies as scientific racism, and who was banned from YouTube earlier this year. Stefan Molyneux is the guy that measures people's brains and shit in it, so yeah, that's no loss, but still, you know? There's still a point there about moderation, about censorship that Joe definitely needs to address. Rogan has given people all the people like this access to gigantic audience, and Rogan rarely challenges his guests. Again, this is a really bad article. He does challenge his guests on a constant basis, to be fair, allowing them to launder their bad ideas on the show. Data Society researcher Becca Lewis has argued that Rogan giving a platform to these people has led his audience to down a more extremist rabbit holes on YouTube. Lewis describes Rogan as a libertarian influencer with mainstream appeal. This is a bizarre takedown on somebody, isn't it? Again, I don't really mind it. I think everybody should be given a platform to say exactly what they want. I think it's up to us as a public to decide who we amplify, who we listen to. You know, going around policing what people can and cannot say on different platforms is absolutely insane. Once you start doing it for one person, you have to do it for others, and then where do you draw the line? And again, if you're a business and you want to attract the biggest audience, you want to make money, you live in a capitalist world, that's what you're about, you have to look at the objectively and just essentially pick the best, not best of bad, but you have to look at it objectively and pick and figure out a solution that works best for your company in the long term, and not only fixate on these ideological battles that might just be an issue for the moment that we're in at the moment, but then, you know, 10 years down the line, it's not a situation. Because prior to this, Joe Rogan existed, what, in you know, in a post-social justice world, Joe Rogan existed uncontested for a long period of time. The moment things change, particularly and societally, he then became a problematic figure, which he isn't really, objective if you think about it, right? The fact that he puts, you know, I look at the Candace Owens interview being a good example of it, right? Candace Owens talks out of her bloody ass, and he gave her a platform, and she essentially hung herself on that show, right? She essentially proved that she didn't really have much about her, right? She was a grifter in her own right, and that was it, right? So if you were an objectively rational person who went into that conversation with an open mind, willing to kind of, you know, be swayed either way, you probably left from that conversation thinking, you know what, this kind of sewing woman doesn't have a Scooby. She doesn't even know what she's talking about, right? She's a complete dunce. And you just step away from it and keep it moving. But you don't say, ban her, get her off the platform, take away her PayPal, and not allow her the opportunity to speak on some of the biggest platforms out there in the public square. Effectively take away her possibility to make money, to put a roof over her head, just because you don't agree with her political leanings or with her worldview. That isn't the right way to go about things, in my opinion. It continues, it says, in another recent episode, Rogan explained a joke he made in 2016 about Caitlyn Jenner's transition, describing Jenner as he and using her dead name, Bruce. Rogan also mischaracterized the reason for Jenner's transition, saying that she might be the crazy woman thing. He said she's homophobic. As recently as August 31st, in what he said was the first episode of the podcast for Spotify, Rogan joked that the Democratic Party just want to talk shit and make sure everyone is trans. Jesus Christ. Taking these jokes out of context again is so horrible. So he followed this up by saying, I don't mean that trans people, I'm with you. He also said my only pushback is about trans people competing in females as females in fighting. Rogan is a UFC commentator and was referring to his long-standing objection to trans women fighting other women in MMA in recent, which is, you know, shouldn't really be an argument, innit? That should just, I don't really see why this is a debate. It should just be like, why can't it just make a division for trans people? That would just kill the debate completely. I think, you know, putting women into an octagon with people that are trans or with people who have gone through some sort of trans procedure isn't safe on both fronts. It just doesn't make any sense. And the best way to kind of acknowledge their existence, I think, and in a respectful way, would be to just to create another division. You know, objectively putting... Yeah, it just doesn't make any sense. That's a mad one even to get involved in. It says, in recent days, Donald Trump said he'd be willing to go on JRE to debate Joe Biden on Wednesday. Trump sent an email to supporters in which he asked them to petition, demand Joe Biden to come out of his basement to agree to a 4-hour long debate with President Trump. Joe Rogan announced he moved to Spotify in May. The JRE debuted on Spotify September 1st and will become exclusive available on the platform later this year, according to a statement from Spotify. In his announcement, Rogan said, Spotify want me just to keep doing what I'm doing here. It's just a licensing deal, so Spotify, if I won't have any creative control. So again, interesting, man. I'm gonna keep an eye on this. I want to see how this develops. Will Joe have to change the way he approaches his content, which I don't think he'll ever do? That's what makes him special. Or will Spotify come in with the editorial hammer and decide what and how he can speak about certain things on his podcast? But either way, it's gonna be interesting to see how this develops going on. Let me know what your comments are regarding this issue in the comments down below. Do you think Joe Rogan is a transphobe? Do you think Caitlyn Jenner is overreacting? Do you think Spotify will cave and essentially kill the deal and still have to pay him out? What do you think will happen in this situation?